Good morning, everyone. Just a quick note about the opening hymn this morning. It is number 372. It has an optional substituted middle verse. And because today is the Feast of Saints Peter and Paul, we will be using the optional verse for the Feast of Saints Peter and Paul as the second verse. So that will be the first verse as normal, the second verse substituted for Saints Peter and Paul, and the final verse as normal. Thanks.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Welcome to Mass this morning, which has been offered for the repose of the soul of Dr. Martin Iverson. It's good to have his family here with us. You are most welcome, most welcome. Today we keep the feast of Saints Peter and Paul, which is such an important feast, that it replaces the Sunday. So there's something there, hopefully, as we remember these two very ordinary, very frail, very fallible men that can help strengthen us on our journey of faith, living with different challenges in a different world to the one which they lived in. And the children are going to go to explore that in their own liturgy of the word. If anybody made figures last week, then they're on the side if you want to take them home with you. Yeah? Go on, big man. There you go. Remember last week that Adam told us the story of what they've been looking at. One of the comments on the online live stream was, next week he should give the homily. So, sisters and brothers, let's acknowledge our own weakness and frailty and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
At
the right hand of the Father, you stand and intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us one day together to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who on the solemnity of the apostles, Peter and Paul, give us the noble and holy joy of this day, grant, we pray, that your church may in all things follow the teaching of those through whom she received the beginnings of right religion. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. King Herod started persecuting certain members of the church. He beheaded James, the brother of John. And when he saw that this pleased the Jews, he decided to arrest Peter as well. This was during the days of unleavened bread. And he put Peter in prison, assigning four squads of four soldiers each to guard him in turns. Herod meant to try Peter in public after the end of Passover week. All the time Peter was under guard, the church prayed to God for him unremittingly. On the night before Herod was to try him, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, fastened with double chains, while guards kept watch at the main entrance to the prison. Then suddenly, the angel of the Lord stood there, and the cell was filled with light. He tapped Peter on the side and woke him. "Get up," he said, "hurry," and the chains fell from his hands. The angel then said, "Put on your belt and sandals." After he had done this, the angel next said, "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me." Peter followed him, but had no idea that what the angel did was all happening in reality. He thought he was seeing a vision. They passed through two guard posts, one after the other, and reached the iron gate leading to the city. This opened of its own accord. They went through it and had walked the whole length of one street when suddenly the angel left him. It was only then that Peter came to himself. "Now I know it is all true," he said. "The Lord really did send his angel and has saved me from Herod and from all that the Jewish people were so certain would happen to me." The word of the Lord.
His praise always on my lips. In the Lord my soul shall make its boast. The humble shall hear and be glad. From all my terrors, the Lord has set me free. Glorify the Lord with me. Together let us praise his name. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. From all my terrors he set me free. From all my terrors the Lord has set me free. Look towards him and be radiant. Let your faces not be abashed. When the poor cry out, the Lord hears them and rescues them from all their distress. From all my terrors, the Lord has set me free. The angel of the Lord is encamped around those who revere him to rescue them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. They are happy who seek refuge in him. From all my terrors, the Lord has set me free.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. My life is already being poured away as a libation, and the time has come for me to be gone. I have fought the good fight to the end. I have run the race to the finish. I have kept the faith. All there is to come now is a crown of righteousness reserved for me, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all those who have longed for his appearing. The Lord stood by me and gave me power, so that through me the whole message might be proclaimed for all the pagans to hear. And so I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from all evil attempts on me and bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Of the underworld can never hold out against it. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he put this question to his disciples: Who do people say the Son of Man is? And they said, Some say he is John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But you, he said, who do you say I am? Then Simon Peter spoke up. You are the Christ, he said, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, "Simon, son of Jonah, you are a happy man, because it was not flesh and blood that revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. So I now say to you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the underworld can never hold out against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be considered bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be considered loosed in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Possibly an appropriate gospel, because he's talking about keys, and we're in the middle, as you'll have seen from the newsletter, of the process of changing keys, because the lock on the side door has finally given up the ghost. I suspect it's been there almost since the time the Father Kelly room was set up, but it's dead in the water. And so we're having to find out, first of all, who has keys, because we didn't know who hasn't got keys. And then we're giving out the new keys. So I gave a new key to Peter when he arrived this morning, and he had to sign for it. And to sign, as everybody's signing, as Sue insists, I have to sign as well, that you will use the key properly. You'll use the key for the purpose for which it's given, which is not just to get in and out of the church when it's locked, but you don't decide you're going to have a rave in here in the wee small hours of the morning. Sorry to disappoint your house. Or any other such thing. It's given for a purpose. And there, I think, is something around the symbolism when Jesus uses these words with Peter. "I give you the keys," he said. These aren't just any keys. It's not the keys from the Father Kelly room door. But these are the keys of the kingdom. And so, in being given the keys of the kingdom, that definition itself sets how they can be used. Does that make sense? So Peter isn't given universal powers of doing what on earth he likes. "I don't like this side of the church, so I'm going to lock him out. You know, this side of the church has greased my palm. Therefore, you can come in." No, it's not about that. We need to look at what Jesus says about this kingdom of his and where this kingdom is to be found, which means we need to ponder the Gospels and what Jesus says and what Jesus does. And we know the kingdom in the teaching of Jesus has to be found in little things. Kingdom's like, well, it's like a measure of yeast that goes in and is mixed in with the dough. Now I have a bread maker in the house. I like to make my own bread. But I can tell you, because I follow the recipe religiously, you know, 1 milliliter of water too much has to come out. 1 not enough has to go in. But it takes 400 grams of flour for the bread maker to make bread. It takes 7 grams of yeast. So it's a tiny thing, tiny little thing. It's like a mustard seed, which is the tiniest of the seeds, but grows so that the birds of the air can shelter in its shade. It's like a shepherd. So if you want to be there in the name of the king, you need to know who and how your king is. Our king is the one who doesn't exclude anybody. 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 But if one wanders, leaves the 99 where they are grazing and goes off to seek out the one who's lost, the one who can't be found. And when he finds them, when he finds this sheep, when he finds this lamb, he doesn't give it a good kicking and say, get back in with the rest of them. No, he picks it up and holds it against his breast to bring it home. So the kind of kingship we're talking about, the kind of kingdom we're talking about, is something very different than what our society might want us to think about or to believe when we use these terms. And that's important. What's also, I believe, very important is those occasions when Jesus turns to the crowd. Now the crowd, that's us. Really, we're the crowd. We're not the Pharisees, and we're not the high priest, and not the Sadducees. We're not the royal family. It's the crowd. And at the time of Jesus, we know very well, it was pretty much impossible for most people to be able to keep the law in anything like its purity. But Jesus looks at them and says, the kingdom of heaven is among you. The kingdom is here among you, in how you love and care, how you live and serve, how you reach out, how you include. All of these show that the kingdom is here. Maybe you don't manage to keep a kosher kitchen. Maybe you don't manage, but those are peripheral things. Peripheral things. God sees the heart. I was wondering, as I heard the first reading there, and this is just the question that you may want to take away with you. It may well be that when Peter was in prison, an angel came from God, so a spiritual being sent by God. I like to think, this is only me now, so I'm not suggesting this is in any way the teaching of the church or anything else. This is just my poor little opinion. But it may well be that there was somebody in the prison who was so insignificant that the soldiers didn't even notice that he or she was there. Might have been the person who went to empty do the slopping out. It may have been anything like that. And that person opened the gates and let Peter out and led him down the street and then left him. So the question that came to me in that first reading was, who are the angels in our lives? It's an expression we use, isn't it? You know? You're an angel. You're an angel. Yeah, I know Debs is the angel, but who are our angels? Who are those who, when we are in dire distress, who are the ones who come to us? Who are the ones who set us free? And maybe as we pray the Mass today, we can include in our prayers a prayer for the angels in our lives, as Peter and Paul did. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I believe in God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lordly Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's pray then for our Holy Father, Pope Francis, for all the leaders of the churches, for the leaders of our world's faiths, and for all people of goodwill. Lord, in your mercy, pray for our parish community, for all those who are in any kind of need, and that the Lord will show us how we can be angels in their lives. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those in civil authority. Do so especially today, as this week sees us gathered for a general election. Lord, in your mercy. For the gift of children in our midst, and thanking God that they have such wonderfully strong lungs. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those who are sick and suffering, those who suffer in body, mind, and spirit, those who care for them, especially for their family members. Lord, in your mercy. Last week, as I said, I was looking through the live stream comments and saw that we had somebody with us from us last Sunday from Ghana. So let us pray for all those who week by week join us in worship in all kinds of different parts of the world, who find a sense of belonging here with us at Our Lady's. Lord, in your mercy. For those who've died, those who've gone before us into God's presence, that as we pray for them, they may pray for us, still walking our own journeys to God. And remember Dr. Martin, especially today. Lord, in your mercy. Let's just take a moment of silence to bring our own prayers. And we ask Mary to pray with us. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Loving God, hear us as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Should I put it on the altar? Well done. Good lad. Are you going to explain?
Yes.
You are?
Yes.
Do you want to turn and face the people then?
Yes.
Right. Okay. Go for it.
What we have been doing today is we've been
thinking
about Saint Paul and
Saint Peter.
Saint Peter. and we've drawn stuff that we could help people to do.
That you can help people to do?
Everyone to do.
Everyone. Well done. Good stuff. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Good. Sisters and brothers, let's pray together that this, your sacrifice and mine, may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father. May the prayers of the apostles, O Lord, accompany the sacrificial gifts that we present to your name for consecration. And may their prayers make us devoted to you in celebration of the sacrifice through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. By your providence, the blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, bring us joy. Peter foremost in confessing the faith, Paul its outstanding preacher. Peter who established the early church from the remnant of Israel. Paul, teacher of the Gentiles that you call. And so each in a different way gathered together the one family of Christ. And revered together throughout the world, they share one martyr's crown. And therefore, with all the angels and the saints, we praise you, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down upon them like the dewfall your Spirit, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup and once more giving thanks, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, drink from it. For this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, sharing in the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of love, together with Francis our Pope and Terence Patrick our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember your servant, our brother, Dr. Martin, whom you've called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. And remember all our sisters and brothers who've fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them all, Father, into the light of your face. And have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, in him, God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Jesus taught us to call God Father, and so we dare to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now
forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of the church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and who reign, forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
It's okay. Don't yeah. It's just yeah, okay. Yeah. Lamb of God.
Take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Bless those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. The body of Christ. That's it. That's good. Just wait there a second. I just need one of you. That's all. So do you want to? Yeah. Okay. Don't go away. I need you. Straight. The blood of Christ. I'm going to need to take some from you halfway through. Okay, you can come down with me now. And you need to stand in the middle there. That's it. Don't move. The body of Christ. 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 body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. Body of Christ. Lord bless you, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. Body of Christ. The 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 body of Christ. Body of Christ. The 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 body of Christ. Thank you. No, don't go away. Don't go away. Let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, who have been renewed by this sacrament, so to live in the church, that persevering in the breaking of the bread and in the teaching of the apostles, we may be one heart and one soul, made steadfast in your love, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Sit down just for a moment, please. So as you've seen there, there's a retiring collection today, which is for Peter's Pence. It's taken all around the world. It's taken in the wealthiest of the parishes. It's taken in the poorest of the parishes. We contribute together to support the outreach work of the Holy Father. This Friday is First Friday, so there's Mass with the sacrament of the sick for those who wish. And details are there for the PTFA Summer Fair, which is also on Friday. Additional altar servers. I think we're now up as far as 6 new servers. It's good. We're now up as far as 2 new Eucharistic ministers. So please do think, pray, if that might be a service that you might be able to give to the body of Christ, to supporting the body of Christ, to feeding, nourishing the body of Christ. That's it, I think. And we've done birthdays for this month, so that's done. Thank you. Thank you for coming to Mass and being with us. And we've said the prayer. So if you'd like to stand, please. Would you like to tell them to bow their heads? May Almighty God bless you, for he has made you steadfast in St. Peter's saving confession, and through it has set you on the solid rock of the Church's faith. Amen. And having instructed you by the tireless preaching of St. Paul, may God teach you constantly by his example to win brothers and sisters for Christ, so that by the keys of St. Peter, the words of St. Paul, and by the support of their prayers, God may bring us happily to that homeland that Peter attained on a cross and Paul by the blade of a sword. So try that one again. And Paul by the blade of a sword. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever. Thanks be to God.
For all the sorrow,
told you about it from. It's all right.